Nobody likes somebody who talks about themselves. So it's a balance. Learn how to talk about yourself, but don't get caught talking about yourself too long. And so he brought up a really good point where it's the art of sort of socialization, the art of gathering new clients, where you're able to kind of give your features and benefits confidently of who you are, turn it around and ask about them. And then often they'll do the same. They'll turn it back to you and bring it back to them. And that's how you can win clients a little bit easier. This is sort of something to remember in open houses. Open houses are tricky. Getting new clients in open houses for those that do it and those that like it can be very, very good at it. Some people have no interest in it, and that's fine. But at the end of the day, when you think about what we do, is we're in the business of attracting people. That's our business. It's a people business. And our goal is to attract new people to us and new high quality people. So I think being able to take some personal time and sit down and sort of say, hey, what features and benefits do I have? What experience do I have that separates me from the next realtor or so that is always in competition with me? You know, even when you think you have a client that's yours, a past client that's yours, and we find ourselves in situations where we just feel that, I've got this client there, 100% they're mine. You know, internally, you think that they're yours, and you put sort of a laissez-faire effort into it because you think you've got it in the bag. Think again. I think all of us that have got experience have probably been in situations more than once where we thought we've had a client and all of a sudden, whoa, something else happens, right? And so I think there's lots of opportunity out there in this market, and there's a lot of talking to be done in this market. Backyard barbecues, it's summertime. It's a super social time. And, you know, I was out at the beach last night with my daughter in the West End, and it was just packed. Like, it was crazy. And almost two packed. Like it was a bad scene. But it put a light bulb off in my head where I'm like, here we are, we're post COVID. Everybody's desperate to just like socialize and get out. And these are great opportunities for us to, look, to just downtime, be social, be around our friends. But practice talking about the market in an optimistic way. Practice talking about yourself in the market in an attractive way that attracts people to you. So there are things to think about, because how we grow our business is we all have independent different ways that we do it. Some of us sort of are outwards marketing. But one of the best ways to grow your business is just personally being out there, socializing and attracting it to you by being attractive. And by being attractive, you know, it's a conscious way of communicating with people. It's a conscious way of talking with people. And it's a conscious way of getting them to open up to you. And so everybody likes to be around somebody and work with somebody who's optimistic, positive minded, and of course, trust, right? And so, learning how to talk about bad news, I think, takes effort and takes skill. And you have to always, whenever you're in the presence of somebody, you have to put yourself and say, what do they care about? So I'm talking to somebody who is a townhouse buyer, and it's the stats aren't great, and or a townhouse seller, you know, and that corner of the market's poor. You know, think about your response into their corner of the market. Hey, the market's doing this in general. However, in your corner of the market, here's what's happening, and here's some good news, and here's some optimism. How do you feel? And it's an age-old thing that I've always learned to do, is turn it back to somebody and just say, how do you feel? And you know, I think in terms of an elevator pitch, there's lots of little, I think each one of us all have our own little things that we say and do repeatedly to clients that work. And I think it's a good time to sort of just brush up on those and practice your, let's call it, elevator pitch. And be ready for it, because you quite often your elevator pitch on working with you, or a small little opportunity, can come up at the most unplanned time and catch you off guard. And some of those can be the best opportunities, you know, where you run into somebody outside in a shop that you've seen forever and they're like, oh, hey, I was meaning to reach out to you. And you have a quick little engagement, and that's a listing. And so sometimes you just have a fraction of a second to do a quick little engagement, maybe with a little bit of an elevator pitch that'll lead to, you know, further business. So anyways, food for thought. That's kind of what I wanted to share with everybody today, was just think about and practice your elevator pitch. We use it consistently. It's a very, very big part of our business. We use it professionally in professional settings, but we also use it in non-professional settings, in private social life too. So just a friendly reminder that I wanted to share with everyone.
Appreciate that. I had a bunch of questions I wanted to ask you, and I think that one kind of in reverse order. What's the best piece of advice you could give to somebody starting in the real estate industry? I think that would have answered that one perfectly.
If you're starting in the industry, you're learning how to talk. You're learning how to talk. So you're reaching out to, you know, and even not just new, but seasoned veterans as well. I mean, we're reaching out to people. And we're talking with people, we're communicating with them. Also, often passively, we're sending out a newsletter, we're doing on something on social media, and then something outward bound like that transitions to a text or to an email or to a phone call. I have a pyramid of importance. I work with a pyramid of importance. Face-to-face is the top of the pyramid. Phone call is just a little bit below. Email is a bit below that. And at the very bottom of the barrel, which is the worst of the worst, is text. And text I'm always really, really cautious of. it's got very good attributes to it, but in terms of building a relationship and it's super poor. And I always look to escalate it.
Hi, Linda.
To the top as possible.
Hello. Hello.
Hello, Darren.
Hello. Hi, Linda.
Darren, I'm at the bank.
Okay, thanks, Darren. Okay. If you don't mind, do you mind if I ask briefly about some of your backgrounds, how long you've been in the industry, where you're from, what brought you into it?
I lost track of time now, but I think it's probably like 12 or 13 years. Originally from Toronto, I came to Vancouver, knew two people. Neither of them wanted to buy or sell, and I was hooped. So like all of us, got out there, and I'm a people person. I like people. I'm confident face-to-face. Open houses were one of the ways I sort of built my business. I still to this day, believe it or not, those that know me personally, I still to this day have a phobia of the phone. Still to this day, I've overcome it. But when I first started this business, I could not pick up the phone and talk to people. That's how bad my phobia was. And we all have challenges in life. That was mine. I worked through it very, very, very hard. It's one of the hardest things I had to overcome. Now I'm comfortable on it naturally, but still inside of me, I have this phobia of the phone when I call people, still to this day. But I've overcome it. And and it kind of goes back a little bit into the elevator pitch and sort of knowing who and what you are. You know, and I think you have to have an honest look at yourself and say, hey, what are my true strengths? Focus on your strengths and get really, really, really good at them. Some people are door knockers. Some people are phone callers. Some people are face-to-face. I love face-to-face, so I love being social. I love social gatherings. I like being out there in front of people. That's my go-to. I've been terrible at calling past clients and calling in, hey, how are you checking in? I'm really bad at that. But I do make an effort to get in front of people, you know, quite frequently. And so I work with and sharpen my comfort zone and what I'm good at.
So you're saying you weren't blessed with an overabundance of friends and extended family who were just itching to get you to list their place?
Zero. No, I did open houses incessantly. I went to social media as well. Like I saw the value in social media in the very beginning, and I got out there to meet, and I created some, you know, a great blog that kind of gave me, you know, cold leads and work cold leads from there. And quite often in the beginning, like, and even to this day, I'm sure many of us have been in a situation where we meet new people and we have very little phone dialogue with them when we meet them face to face for the first time. I mean, I've done that more times than I can count, where I've met a client for the first time. We haven't even talked, we've just emailed. It's been very sort of short, quick, cryptic. And it's like, whether it's a buyer or seller, meet them for the first time, you know, face to face with very little background. And that I love, because that's where I feel like, okay, that's my strong suit. Once I get in front of them face to face, we're good. I feel super confident about it. So steering things towards your comfort zone is important. You know, I think all of us are going to be out this summer socializing with people, you know, in group settings. And I think put a little bit of effort and thought into how to, because everybody's always going to come to you, what's going on in the market. And right now, everybody needs to know, everybody's curious what's going on in the market. So put a little bit of effort into it. Often when I'm going to a barbecue, that is, I think about who's going to be there ahead of time. And it's just thoughts that I have. And I think about, and I just remember names so that I don't get caught forgetting people's names. I put effort into my personal life to help my business life, is what I'm saying. So when I go to an event, I think about who's going to be there. I just refresh my memory of their names. And then I have a little bit of like internal dialogue of how to handle quick, light conversations that can convert to business. And I do a tremendous amount of business that way. Some of us feel like that's just a natural thing that we naturally have inside of us. I think we all do. That's why we're in this line of business. But I think if you just rely on your nature versus nurture, work at it, you'll get a better return.
You mentioned that you're from Toronto. What brought you to Vancouver?
The good life. you know, great question. I'm a skier. I'm an outdoor person. So I came to ski, moved to Whistler, lived in Whistler, taught skiing for many years. I taught private skiing for Whistler Blackcomb. And I had a really, really awesome Rolodex of fantastic clients. And maybe when I retire, I'm going to go back to that job because I absolutely love it. Over the years, I had a lot of clients that would use me over and over again. And I had a very wealthy stockbroker from New York City with his family that was in his third year of hiring me for over a week. And it was great life. One day he looked at me, he's like, "Well, I'm thinking about buying some real estate. I really want to get a nice place." I was like, "Oh, no kidding." Okay. I skied him and his family over to Sunridge. For those of you guys that know Whistler, Sunridge is sort of the most exclusive homes, ski in, ski out. I was like, "Oh, check it out. This is Sunridge. Look at this. You can ski in, you can ski out." And lo and behold, he buys a $5 million home with Maggie Thornhill. Has me over with my friend to the house, sitting in the house. I'm like, Jesus, Willikers, this guy just bought a $5 million house. I put my calculator together. I'm like, okay, onwards and upwards, there's more in life. And I love the process. My mom was in real estate. So, you know, I had knowledge and background of this industry from her. But like every child, whatever your parent does, you want to do the opposite. So I did the opposite for the majority of my life. But through ski instructing, I realized I enjoy people. I'm a people person. I like being out there. And I knew I had the confidence and the skill set to be able to do it. And before I got into real estate, actually, I was um, I was I had to make a decision if I wanted to do real estate in Whistler or in the city. And at that time, we didn't have a family, and I kind of felt the city, North Van, was probably the best landing pad, you know, to raise children and still have an outdoor active life, but also have the benefits to the city. And yeah, I'm super passionate about North Van. I love it. I think it's got the balance of everything. And, you know, on that note, Andrew, you know, I think of my personal story, but whenever I talk about my story, I think about who I'm talking to. So although I'm talking to a group setting here, if I was talking to a certain person, individual, I'd be catering my story to what they care about. And so I think that's really important message for everyone just to remember when you're talking to somebody in a real estate, we're always in real estate, but when you're talking to someone, be conscious of who you're talking to and what they care about. Think about them, not yourself. And so often when I talk to somebody, and this is almost by default, I talk to them in a way, a careful way, that I'm conscious that it's a dual engagement and we're talking about topics that entice them to engage and that they care about.
Okay. I like the way you've put that, and I think that's some good things to focus on. I've got, I just want to know, if, in your opinion, what do you think are some of the biggest changes to the industry that have shifted the industry? I mean, we, you know, I was talking to somebody recently, and they were talking about how the CPS, you know, used to be, you know, half a page on a cocktail napkin, and you just have to know how to write your name. And these days it's like 10 plus pages plus the disclosure and so many other associated documents, and, or other people talk about changes in technology and things like that. I'm curious. I mean, change seems to be inevitable, but in your experience, what do you think have been the changes that have really shifted the industry?
Look, a lot of the changes that have happened in the last year, we've all griped about them, and we have right to. Some of them are terrible, let's be honest. Like, from more paperwork to more encumbrances to sign this document, I can't talk to you, agency, all this stuff is just like, it all equates to one thing: making clients' lives more uncomfortable in the presence of professionals. I think we can all agree how many times we've done an open house or come across a new client where they are sort of like war victims. They've been out there looking for a realtor, metaphorically, and they've just come across 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 uncomfortable situations where they've just been mishandled and not able to attach to somebody. So all of the changes in the industry, let's call a spade, are challenges. And clients have been on the receiving end of this. So for those of us that polish our elevator pitch and are able to make people feel comfortable right away, there's more business to be done and better quality business to be done. And I've put a lot of effort into that. Now without open houses, we get a lot of buyers direct. So those of us with listings, you're probably seeing Realtor.ca, REW, the leads coming in are becoming higher. And these are a lot of clients coming direct to listing agents. And, you know, there's different opportunities out there. But I think all of the changes, Andrew, equate to more opportunity for those of us that can make people feel comfortable right off the get-go. And I don't jump on people with agency. I don't jump on people with a lot of, I'm also a little bit of a rule breaker too. So I'll be cautious to kind of, you know, promote how I do, not a rule breaker, but not necessarily a rule follower. But I care about one thing, and I put one thing at the very top of the list, is making the person in front of me that I'm looking to maybe see if we're a fit as a client, I'm putting their comfort at the top of the list. That's number one. That's how I think in my brain. So, and by that, I choose what questions to ask them in sequence. I choose how to engage with people at a very sort of soft, nice, get to know you sort of level. And then I leave the more important questions to the latter end, once we've kind of established a little bit of know, like, and trust. I'm always curious to know if somebody owns real estate. I'm always curious to know where they're at in the situation, but I don't jump on those questions too quick, too early on. You know, we look to sort of build a little bit of a relationship, build a little bit of feeling together, and then slowly get to the, to the, to the meat and potatoes. But essentially, I think all the changes are good. You just have to know how to work them in your favor.
So it sounds like your superpower as a realtor then is your ability to be more personable with people that you meet.
No superpower, just conscious effort, just consciousness. I'm always aspiring to do better. And by no means am I, feel like I've arrived in any sort of shape or form. We're all different. We all have our ways of how we do things. But just being a people person, I like people and I like engagement with them. And I like working with quality people, to be honest. And so by polishing my personal skills with people, I think I've been, knock on wood, been able to attract a better quality of client as well. Years ago, I was concerned. We're always concerned with volume, right? How much money can I make? How many deals can I do? Just volume, just quantity, right? And I've done some big quantities in the past, and it's been great. And it's always an aspiration that we all have, but there also is a quality aspect too. And some of my big quantity years were like pretty big headache years too. You know what I mean? I was like, oh my God, I need to get better quality clients. And when you have a high quality client, I think we can all agree, it's an amazing business. It's amazing. When you get a low quality client, it's like, and so attracting the right people that you want to work with is important. It's something that I'm conscious of. And I think it's one of the sort of the key things that I wanted to sort of share with everybody is put some conscious effort into what type of people you want to work with.
So it's sounds like a bit of a process of refinement as you go along.
Yeah. I think for myself, it's imagery. It's imagery. It's who you associate with. But I think it's also a little bit in, what you put out there. And so, and I think working on your language and working on how you talk about the market and what you're looking for and what you are as a realtor, because everybody wants to know, like, what type of realtor are you, right? Everybody knows a realtor. And just as a friendly reminder, the one thing I never do, I never, ever, ever, ever ask if somebody has a realtor. I never do that. If you do, I completely understand. I mean, I'm sure we've all tried it. If you're like, oh, hi, nice to meet you, Susie. Nice to meet you, Bob. Are you guys working with a realtor? If that's the first question you ask somebody, I 100% guarantee you, they're probably going to, out of nervousness, probably say yes, even if it's true or not. And just because it's like, you've asked me kind of like a strong question right off the get-go. And when you think about, and it's an important question to ask, and maybe it does have a place, I think it does have a place, but I leave it to the very end. And people that are in committed relationships where their realtor is looking, their realtor, and they feel that their realtor is servicing them, they'll tell you right away, we're working with a realtor. You don't have to ask. They'll come out and say it. 100%. And so often when I meet people and I engage with them, we just build a relationship and talk. And that's part of making people comfortable. The analogy is sort of like dating. You go to a bar and the first question you ask a woman is she married? It's like, it's not offensive, but it's out of place. Right. And so the sequencing of questions, I think, is important. And the sequencing of engagements in meeting new people is really important to have a higher turnover of success.
Do you still operate your blog?
No, I don't. But I do value online lead generation big time. I let go of it years ago. My business sort of grew sufficiently enough just through, just organically, just through network, just through socializing, repeat and referral. Repeat and referral for me has been huge. And I've learned how to ask for referrals. I've learned how to talk about myself and talk about my business in a way that sets it up for referrals. And that goes back into your elevator pitch. Like when you really work on your elevator pitch, when you really work on it, your elevator pitch will grow your business. It'll grow your business. And so I tell people, you know, part of my pitch is like, hey, you won't see me on the back of a bus. You won't see me on a bus shelter. I don't do that type. I don't do outwards marketing. And this is part of my first initial conversation that I have with people. I say my business is 100% repeat referral. I look after people deeply. I'm not a transactional agent. I'm a relationship agent. And I educate people on the difference between a transactional agent and a relationship agent. And I talk about how I'm relationship driven. And I talk a little bit about my client database and how everything that I've done has been repeat and referral and helping, you know, further and further. And so when I meet people right away, they're like, okay, I know how Roland's business works. I know how he works. I know how his business works. And I've planted the seed for, okay, he cares about us. He cares not about the money in the transaction. He's willing to steer us in the right direction because it's not a transaction for him. He wants us as long-term clients and everybody related to us as long-term clients. And I tell people that in my elevator pitch, in both listings and both buyers.
I want to take an opportunity here to open up some questions with some of the attendees here. And there's been a couple of comments so far. And Michelle is asking, how do you ask for referrals?
By not asking for them. That's true. I ask for referrals by not asking for them. So I'll go back to sort of a light version of my elevator pitch. When I'm doing my CMA and I'm going, and my CMA is sort of a, my CMA is just an organization of pages that are mental cues of what to talk about at that point in time in the process. When we talk about our business, and this is something I think we should all practice doing, is know how to talk about your business. How does your business operate? This is barbecue talk, it's professional talk. And so for myself, I've developed this little bit of sort of like a 1-2 on how my business operates, where I basically say, as I told you, I said, look, I'm not the type of realtor that is, you know, out there. And a lot of public actually make fun of very well-known realtors that are everywhere, faces everywhere. And from my experience, in a lot of people have a negative view of that. And so because I'm not out there on the back of buses, I turn it to my advantage and say, no, I don't do that. This is how I work. I look after people genuinely and their best interests. And from that, my business has over the years developed into repeat and referral. And I almost now exclusively work with repeat and referral clients. And people are like, oh, that's the best type of business. That's great. No, I really like that. And people attach to that. And that's a way of building trust. It's true. First of all, it's true. It's trust. It shows that, you know, over time you've looked after people and they've been happy and happy enough to use you again and again, and then refer family members and or friends. So how do you ask for referrals? You ask for referrals by knowing how to talk about how you work as a realtor and how your business is built. I think if you ask for a referral, you're doing it wrong. You won't get them, right? You won't get them. by educating the people that you work with and how your business works, that's where you'll prompt them to be like, ah, okay, that's how your business works. You're prompting them to let them know that it is acceptable for them to think of you for something else or somebody else. Yes, you ask for the business, but you're asking for the business in sort of an open platform, a more comfortable way. If you sort of point blank say, do you know somebody or do you know somebody? It's a harsher question. It's a more sort of poignant, aggressive question. They're different styles, but I've always been really successful in getting referrals just by sort of saying, hey, this is how my business works. This is where the success I've been able to do, and this is why I run my business this way. And then that usually makes people comfortable enough to be like, oh, I should put you in touch with my sister, or I should put, et cetera.
Awesome, appreciate that. Anybody else have any questions? I'll let people stew over that for a second. You just alluded briefly to your confidence in, I guess, what you consider to be growing trends when it comes to online lead generation.
Yeah, I'll be honest. My online presence and my online lead generation for the last few years has not been at the forefront of my business very much, but I would like to get back to it. And I think into the future, I'm probably going to bring somebody on board on the marketing side of things and grow that a little bit more. I know how it works. I know how to create online leads. And I think now more than ever, there's fantastic opportunity there in that department as people are less milling about. Think about this, there's no open houses anymore. So where are all those people that are milling about open houses that are looking for agents? In my mind, anyone who comes into an open house is looking for a realtor. That's the way my mind works. Unless they're like, I'm working with Mark Haslam, here's his card. but anyone who stumbles into an open house is doing so because, yeah, okay, they're maybe looking at the real estate, that's a small percentage. But most of them are likely looking for guidance in the market or have unanswered questions or there's opportunity. So those people are not coming to open houses now. Where are they? That thirst, that need is still there. Where are they getting it? So it's where to position oneself to receive and connect with people that are out there with questions. And I've noticed just since COVID, on my listings, the amount of realtor.ca leads coming in and the amount of online leads coming in with people just passively looking, hey, can you send me more information about this listing, has spiked big time. And so I think there's a lot of people out there and a lot of opportunity business-wise where people are just sort of floating out there looking to make a connection with a realtor.
Do you mind if I ask then, seeing as you get a lot of realtor.ca inquiries, what sort of conversion rate do you have for those?
It's a good question. You know, we have on days and off days. And I think on the days where I'm like, okay, I feel on it, like, and I get a good flow, my conversion's pretty good. But then I have other days where I'm just like lethargic and like, oh, whatever, or just like I'm low energy. And on those days when I'm trying to convert people and I'm just not enthusiastic or I'm just not my best self, the conversion rate's naturally low. But because I've put a lot of effort into understanding the sequence of how to engage with people from light to a little bit more, because I've really studied that, my online conversion, I think throughout my career or just my light conversion is pretty high. It's pretty high. I would like to think it is, because I take a very sort of slow, soft approach to build, to allow kind of a nice long runway of people to get to know who I am and find ways to find commonalities and ways to connect together, and create that sort of know, like, and trust in the beginning, and then see if there's business there. And it's a dual pre-qualification. I'm trying to figure out if I want to work with them and if they're good business, and vice versa too. I love new business. I love new clients. Repeat referral is bread and butter without question, and existing clients are gold. But I love new business. I love the challenge of somebody new and finding out about them and seeing if we're a good fit. I love it. Yeah. Slow and steady, and thinking about them is kind of the name of the game.
When you talk about expanding your online presence with the intent of capturing more of these leads, are you referring to social media or something like that?
Yeah, I mean, Instagram is obviously the hot to trot today, and it's really powerful. I think there's a lot of not only realtors, but there's a lot of industries that are using Instagram very, very powerfully to create lead capture. And although I'm not doing too much of it right now, I'm aware of it, and probably into the future, I'll sharpen my pencil a little bit on it. But social media is amazing. I call it sort of fishing lures, you know, where you can put a lure out there and it's an attractant to the type of client that you're looking to work with. And so, you know, Instagram is an example of just putting a basic sort of, photo out there, may not be the best lure, but now there's all sorts of engagement options where it's like, click here for more details, or click here to see the video tour. And, you know, there's a lot of, same on Facebook too, right? So Facebook advertising, the complexity of it and the strength of it is enormous, but it ultimately, I found that to get really effective at it, it's now become a pretty big deviation away from our business. And so as much as I honor and I love it, I've realized it's no longer something I have the ability to kind of effectively do myself anymore. It really belongs in the hand of like a true marketing professional who knows the ins and outs and all the small little fine details of social media marketing. So I think in the future, that's probably one of my next directions that I'll go is working with somebody who's like a social media expert and having them on board to kind of, help and assist with that. And you can probably see some, if you're on Instagram and you follow a lot of realtors in our marketplace, you can very quickly identify who's working with a social media expert and who's not. There's a lot of well-known realtors out there that have aligned themselves with social media experts, and you can see it in the volume, the quality, and everything that they're putting out there. It's an investment. I think it's a good investment for sure. Yeah.
Okay, appreciate that. I'd love to hear who you end up engaging with. I'm sure other people have a similar kind of intention, but are struggling to find somebody who's reliable, and reputation referral seems to go a long way.
There's lots of platforms out there for help. In the past, I've used... I've used everything from like Freelancer to a lot of those platforms where you can just quickly hire sort of somebody, electronically to help. I've used a lot of those platforms before. Indeed is sort of one of the most popular sort of hiring mechanisms out there, better than Craigslist. That's a really popular. But there's a tremendous amount of websites out there where you can hire people very cost effectively, like Freelancer, and go online to the world and say, hey, look, I'm looking to hire an online marketing specialist and pull from them. And of course, there's one website at the top of my mind that I just forgot the name of, but there's a lot of help out there available very cost effectively.
Okay, appreciate that. I think that's it for questions, and we're sort of coming to the end of our scheduled time here, but I really appreciate you taking the time to tell us a bit about yourself and get an idea of what your particular brand is all about, which I think is definitely something to think about. I know I've been making a few notes here because I think it's interesting some of the points that you've made. So thanks so much for your time.
You're welcome.
We're going to be continuing the series as we go throughout the summer. Lawrence is away at the moment, but I know that he's going to be back for next week's installment, in which case we'll put out another invite to the webinar, and we'll post some details on the group page. And if there's any requests or anything like that, I'd love to hear it, because we'd love to tailor this to give you what you're interested in. So thanks so much, everybody, for attending. Not a problem. We'll work on the light. In any case, some of the staff are away at the moment on some much needed recovery time, but I'm around if anybody needs to contact me for anything. And I look forward to seeing you next time.
Thanks, Roland. Thanks, Andrew.
Yeah, you're welcome, everybody. You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great week, everyone.
Thanks, Roland.
You're welcome. You're welcome.